Good evening, folks. Welcome. My name is Bart Redford. I represent the KU Center for Russian and East European Eurasian Studies. And on behalf of Carice, I'm going to welcome you to this year's Pali Lecture, featuring the Ukrainian author and political commentator, Yuri Vinichuk. In a moment, I'm going to introduce you to the person most responsible for bringing our speaker here tonight to speak. He's not only going to introduce him, but also act as his interpreter this evening, and that's Dr. Vitaly Chinyetsky. First, though, I'd like to take this opportunity to tell you a little bit about Ukrainian studies, and in particular about the Pali Fund here at KU. The Pali Fund was established by Dr. Michael Pali to promote Ukrainian studies at KU. Many of us know him and remember him from his longstanding work in the libraries, but also his tireless efforts to promote Ukrainian studies here. It features not only a lecture series, but also offers an annual award to an outstanding student specializing in Ukrainian studies. And Dr. Pali's late wife, Lumira, continued to support the fund after his death. And we graciously acknowledge the current support by his son, Peter, and his wife, Linda, who reside in Albany, New York. I'd also like to acknowledge the support of the Ukrainian Club of Kansas City, who have been very actively in supporting us. And in particular, Mr. Peter Yarosevich, who's sitting back here, is present tonight, has contributed himself to support of Ukrainian studies here. University of Kansas, while you may not know this, is one of a handful of universities across the nation which offer Ukrainian studies. That is, not only study the language, but also study the history, the politics, the culture of the country. And we've been fortunate to have Alex and Yasi Tsyo for the entirety of that time in which we've offered Ukrainian studies here. If you don't know either of those, then please take the opportunity to get to know them. They send their regrets. I don't think Yasu is here tonight, but Alex is in D.C. actually working on an interpreting project. But they've been essential to the establishment of the program, and Alex continues every year to lead a study abroad summer intensive language program, an area studies program in Lviv. And we've been fortunate also that we've, you know, aside from Alex and Yasi, we've had a number of different scholars and faculty members here at KU who have added Ukraine as either a research focus or taking it for you know, special interest in terms of teaching, not only in race, but also in fields as diverse as geography and business and so on. To that list, we can add now the newest of our colleagues in the Department of Slavic Languages and Literatures, Dr. Vitaly Chinyetsky. He is a native of Odessa. He has his doctorate in comparative literature from the University of Pennsylvania, and he taught at Columbia University and Miami University of Ohio. His interests are in 20th and 21st century Ukrainian and Russian literature, and I might add that he is the current president of the American Association for Ukrainian Studies. I've known Vitaly only a short while, but I can tell you that already he's impressed us at Carice with his great willingness to contribute his time and his energy to support Ukrainian studies and the mission of Carice. And, even before he started, actually, he was writing to me you know, wanting to get this set up, and it's only because of his personal connections and our, you know, association with our speaker tonight that we were able to bring Mr. Vinichuk in. So I'm going to turn it over to Vitaly for the rest of us.
Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the annual Pali Lecture. It's a great pleasure and honor to see all of you here. And indeed, I'm truly delighted to introduce to you our speaker tonight. Yuri Vinichuk is one of Ukraine's leading, most respected and most influential contemporary writers. He has been very active in Ukrainian literature for at least four decades now, and he is a writer who has been able to bring interest and fascination about Ukrainian culture, society, and politics in its many facets across different genres. Our speaker was born in 1952 in the city of Stanislaviv, which is now called Ivano-Frankivsk in western Ukraine. And He moved to the city of Lviv as a university student in the early 1970s. The early 70s was a very difficult time for Ukraine under Soviet rule. Samizdat, an underground literary almanac called Skrinya, which means the chest, published in Lviv in 1971, which was only noted for the works of experimental innovative writing and was in no way overtly political, was brutally repressed by the authorities. All the participants in the almanac lost their positions, either as students or as faculty, and their careers were ruined for many years. Our guest, even though he was able to complete his university studies as a specialist in philology, that is languages and literature, was not able to practice his profession and was not allowed to publish. He had to earn his living by working as a loader and unloader of groceries, with occasional gigs as a theater set designer, and continued, however, writing underground, and was a very prominent and active member of the literary, artistic, and musical underground of the city of Lviv. Lviv, for those of you who might not know, is a beautiful city, a beautiful historic city. It's a main city in the western part of Ukraine. It's a city with gorgeous medieval, Renaissance, Baroque, and Art Nouveau architecture. And it's a city that played a very important role in Soviet era nonconformist thinking, culture, and politics. It had a similar role to the cities of the Baltic Republics, Vilnius, Riga, Tallinn. It was considered one of the most Western places in their culture and style within the Soviet Union. It was a place with an active hippie culture, an active underground rock music culture, independent literature and arts. However, it was also a city where the repression of free thinking was particularly brutal. Things started warming up and changing a little bit in the early 1980s, when the particularly odious apparatchik, the head of the ideology department of the Ukrainian Communist Party, was finally deposed. So there was a tiny mini thaw in Ukraine before Perestroika. And that's when our guest was finally able to begin publishing literary criticism and translations. However, some of these translations were in fact very unorthodox translations, as he found a way to publish his own original writing as translations supposedly from various ancient languages. For instance, he knew for sure that in Ukraine there were no specialists on medieval Irish Gaelic. So he produced several translations, supposedly of medieval Irish Gaelic epic poetry, the most famous of which was an epic poem by the Irish monk Rian Gabar, who was based in Kiev during the Mongol invasion in the 13th century and described it at all and was able to survive the Batu Khan siege and tell all about. This was created quite a commotion in Ukraine and was actually noted in Ireland, and therefore queries came from Ireland, where was the manuscript discovered? And ingeniously, our author, Mr. Vinichuk, went to the famed Stefanik Library, the scholarly library in the city of Lviv, and he consulted, and in the Habsburg era, there was a periodical called Irische Texte, and 82 volumes of Irische Texte were published, so he wrote back to Ireland that this original manuscript was published in volume 83. But in addition to Irish Gaelic, he created a whole ancient civilization called Arcanum, which was based in Asia Minor. It was a neighbor of the Hittites and the Babylonians in the same times, and he wrote a lot of original writings about Arkhanum, about political repression there, about disrespect for ordinary people and their hopes and aspirations. And the KGB couldn't touch him because it was all about an ancient civilization in Asia Minor. Even though those who could read between the lines obviously could feel that this was an allegory for the situation of contemporary Ukraine under Soviet rule. Finally, in the late 1980s, he was a co-founder of the legendary cabaret called Nezhuris, Don't Be Sad, which was became a major cultural event in the life of the city of Lviv and all of Ukraine. And during the Canadian portion of his North American tour, he was able to reunite with one of his partners, Viktor Morozov, and they did cabaret evenings in Toronto, Montreal, and Ottawa, which were so tremendously successful that there are calls for them to come back and do a second tour. Hopefully Kansas City and Lawrence would be on the itinerary when they do that. Also, starting in the late 1980s, he was able to publish his original writings and also several wonderful anthologies that he has compiled. His writing, I've described in my book on contemporary Russian Ukrainian culture as a particular, peculiar version of magic realist writing. He creates alternative worlds and civilizations that resemble ours, but are slightly different and operate by slightly different rules. Very often they are transgressive. They are transgressive in terms of violence, or they are transgressive in terms of vocabulary, or they are transgressive in terms of sexuality. However, as other critics have noted, he always balanced on the edge of what the public would accept. And so these texts were controversial in the sense that he came all the way to the brink, but then remained at the brink. There were problems. There were more scandals. For instance, one of his publications were the supposed secret diary of Roxolana, the Ukrainian who was taken captive by the Ottoman Turks, who then rose to be the favorite wife and then the only wife of Suleiman the Magnificent, the most powerful of the Ottoman rulers. So this is her very graphic and detailed diary written in early 17th century Ukrainian, and it produced opposing reactions. Some people from the more conservative camps protested the fact that our Nastya from Rohatyn could not have written graphic things like that, and others found the writing tremendously liberating because it allowed them to be able to speak about their own bodies and their experiences. Since independence, he has been very active as a journalist, as a political commentator. He writes often very provocative articles under this pen name Yuzo Observator. He has published several collections of legends of the city of Lviv, and these books are now used as textbooks for local history in local secondary schools. One of his books has a title, for instance, The Mystery of Lviv Coffee, Tajemnitsa Lvivskoye Kavy. So if you wanted to know all about the tradition of coffee houses in Lviv, we have the author who can tell you all about it. And of course, Lviv and Western Ukraine is the place to which we owe the coffee culture of Western Europe, because it was Yuri Kulchinsky, a Ukrainian from Western Ukraine, who during the siege of Vienna was able to go back and forth between the Ottomans and the Viennese. And thanks to him, we now have the wonderful coffee tradition. So among the prolific output of our writer, several novels stand out in particular, and they've received tremendous recognition. In 2005, a new independent, non-corrupt prize for the best book in Ukrainian was established by BBC Ukrainian Service. The very first prize for best Ukrainian book of the year was awarded to our guest, Yuri Vinnichuk, for his novel, Весняні ігри в осінніх садах, spring games in the Autumn Gardens. And then earlier this year, he was awarded the prize for the second time for his novel Tango Smerti, A Tango of Death, a book which we are featuring in tonight's event. This is a wonderful, stunning, and moving book, one of my most personally profound reading experiences that I've had in recent years. The book is a love letter to the city of Lviv, and it brings together two plots, one set in the present, and the other set in the 1920s, 30s, and 40s. And in the 1920s to the 1940s part of the plot, we follow four young men who were best friends. And they, all of them lost their fathers during the Civil War after the end of World War I and the collapse of the Habsburg Empire. They were fighting for the independence of the Western Ukrainian Republic, which also briefly allied with Ukraine proper, but were then arrested and shot by the Bolsheviks in 1921. However, the four young friends come from different ethnic and cultural backgrounds. Only one is ethnically Ukrainian. The others are Jewish, Polish, and German. And this is what is emphasized in the novel, that the city of Lviv traditionally was multi-ethnic and multicultural, but the fact that it was a multi-ethnic, multicultural, and multilingual does not mean that these were communities that existed side by side without communication with each other. In fact, the friendship of our four friends is at the center of the novel. Since the book goes into the 1940s, it deals with the tragedies of World War II. The first Nazi invasion, which was repelled, the first Soviet occupation, 39 to 41, which brought tremendous suffering to the city. And then as Soviet troops were retreating in late June or in July of 41, there was a mass execution of prisoners, which was one of most horrific Soviet era war crimes. Then of course, the Nazi occupation brought the tragedy of the Holocaust. And this novel is the first novel in contemporary Ukrainian literature where the Holocaust and its tragic circumstances are at the center of the narrative. And I'm not going to give away the plot, but this is a very moving and very unusual book which deals with elements of that are profoundly sad, but this is a book which also has elements of humor. It is not laughing at the characters, it's laughing with the characters while they're trying to go on and survive with their lives. And this is a book that will keep you in suspense until the very last page, and you'll find out that there is an incredibly profound and moving resolution about keeping the memory of those who unjustly and unfairly lost their lives, how to keep their memory alive in our present time. So our plan right now will be to have our guest tell a little bit about his literary experiences. He will then, and I will interpret, he will speak in Ukrainian, I will speak in English, interpreting him. He will then read in Ukrainian a fragment of the novel, which you can follow in the handouts you have received. And then, of course, he will be very happy to answer any questions you might have. At the end of the evening, we're fortunate to have several of his books available for sale at the cost of $10 each. We have an anthology of his selected writings in English translation and two books in the original Ukrainian, Tango Smerti, Tango of Death, and one other novel, Divi Nochi, Maids of the Night, which is a very important novel which was published in the early 1990s, but this is a new revised edition. So without further ado, I yield the floor to our guest, Yuri Vinichuk. Thank you.
Віталій мені спростив завдання, бо він розповів все найцікавіше про мене, що я міг розказати.
He says that I have simplified his task because I've already said some of the most interesting things about him. Але я не погоджуся, бо я вважаю, що в твоєму житті, в твоїй творчості є ще дуже багато дуже цікавих сторінок.
Ну, тут єдина ще сторінка не зачеплена, це те, що я, окрім того, що я пишу свої твори, я намагаюся продовжити життя забутим письменником.
One other important contribution that our guest Юрій Винничук considers a big part of his project is trying to keep the memory alive of many unjustly forgotten writers.
Я видав кілька десятків різних антологій, зокрема це кілька томів антології української готичної прози про духів привидів.
He has edited and published numerous anthologies, including several volumes of an anthology of Ukrainian Gothic writing, writing dating back all the way to the Romantic era, about with elements of the supernatural, which are very similar to Gothic literature that was popular in Germany, England, and other places.
Я це робив для того, щоб деякі забуті письменники стали ближчими для сучасного читача, бо якщо видавати їхні основні твори, то їх зараз би ніхто не читав. Але от оповідання гостросюжетні про відьом, чортів, русалок і так далі, вони користуються попитом.
The fact is that some of the works of those writers in their lifetimes considered their most important works are not necessarily going to attract a wide readership now. However, some of their works that they considered trifles, short stories about witches and mermaids and things of that nature, are actually very well done and have found their appreciative audience.
Остання моя антологія – це два товстих томи, кожен такий має по 600 сторінок, присвячена 322 українським поетам, які були репресовані і знищені різними режимами.
My most recent anthology, which is in two volumes, each over 600 pages each, features 322 Ukrainian poets, which were victims of political persecution by different regimes over the history, of the course of the history of Ukraine.
Show of hands, how many people can understand his Ukrainian speech now? Okay, these people understand what you said.
Але, перепрошую, тільки половина аудиторії, а та друга половина все ж таки потребує перекладу.
Справа в тому, що крім нашого національного голодомору, фізичного знищення селянства, було ще інтелектуальний голокост чисто українців, коли знищено було інтелігенцію і весь інтелект нації.
Many people are familiar with Holodomor, the tragedy of the terror famine, the genocidal famine that struck Ukraine in 1932-33. But side by side with that, we had a terrible tragedy of the wiping out, literally, another Holocaust of the Ukraine's best and brightest of Ukrainian intellectuals who perished at the same time.
Багато письменників були розстріляні, причому їх розстрілювали по кілька. Щодня були дні, коли було розстріляно більше 20 письменників.
Many of these writers were shot. In fact, there were certain days on which, on one single day, more than 20 notable writers were shot.
За 4 дні 1937 року, на початку листопада, в урочищі Сандербох в Карелії, було знищено 1100 інтелектуалів українських і українських колишніх військових.
Over the course of only 4 days, at the beginning of November of 1937, in the valley of Sandarmokh in Karelia, which is an autonomous region in northwestern Russia, 1,100 Ukrainian intellectuals and former army officers were physically shot. They had been earlier prisoners at the Solovki concentration camp.
За 4 дні розстріляти таку кількість людей – це було, звичайно, велике звірство. І виконав його начальник концтабору Матвєєв, якого пізніше теж було розстріляно.
This was brutal and terrible thing, and which was also hard work, which was actually accomplished by one person, a certain camp officer by the name of Matveev, and this very often happened. The terror machine then devoured those who were its faithful executioners, and he was too shot.
І разом з тим, коли я займався доями цих розстріляних письменників, я відкрив долі кількох письменників, про яких всі знали, що вони були знищені, а вони, виявляється, вижили.
And when I was researching the fates of some of these writers, I found out about some writers that people thought that had perished, but it turned out that a few of them had actually survived.
Наприклад, доля поета Сергія Кушніренка, який у 1936 році видав збірку поезії і закінчив Варшавський університет.
One of them was Сергій Кушніренко, was a young poet who, based in Western Ukraine, graduated from Warsaw University and published his first collection of poems in 1936.
Про нього ми знали, що він загинув під час війни. Однак виявилось, що він вижив, оселився на Волині в глухому селі, і, маючи високу освіту, знаючи багато мов, в анкеті написав, що він має тільки 5 класів.
His way of surviving, people previously thought that he perished during World War II, was to settle in a village in the middle of nowhere, deep in the forests of Volinia, the area in northwestern Ukraine. And this highly educated man, who was fluent in many languages, wrote in a questionnaire for Soviet authorities that he had only completed 5 grades of elementary education.
Він працював архівником колгоспі, потім продавцем в магазині, помер у 80-х роках, і ніхто не знав, що він був поетом досить відомо.
He died in the 1980s. Before that, he worked in a collective farm or a vendor at a village, you know, general store, and nobody knew that this was actually a noted and very talented poet back in this day.
Серед поетів, які загинули від рук німців, був цікавий поет Яків Альперін, який був єврей за походженням.
Among the poets who perished from the hands of the Germans was a very interesting poet named Яків Гальперін, who was Jewish in terms of his background.
Він народився у 20-му році, до війни писав російською мовою, а під час війни зблизився з українськими націоналістами і писав українською мовою.
He was born in 1920. His early poetry was written in Russian, but during World War II he actually became a sympathizer and supporter of the Ukrainian National Liberation Cause and switched to writing in Ukrainian.
Він жив у квартирі Святозара Драгоманова, сина великого українського філософа і літературознавця, і друкувався в журналі Олени Теліги «Літаври».
He lived in the apartment of a prominent Lviv intellectual, Svitozar Drogomanov, who was the son of Mikhailo Drogomanov, the leading Ukrainian intellectual of the 19th century and uncle of Ukraine's greatest woman writer, Lesya Ukrainka. And his work was published in the journal Litavri, which was published by the greatest Ukrainian woman poet of her generation, Olena Teliga.
Це дуже цікавий факт, про який навіть відгукнувся відомий російський письменник Наум Коржавін. Він написав, що Яшу спасали українські націоналісти.
And even though there's been a lot of historically distrust in that direction, prominent Russian Soviet era dissident writer Naum Koržavin testified that this young man, even called Яша, was saved by the Ukrainian nationalists.
На жаль, Яків, розлучившись зі своєю дружиною, не поділив з нею квартиру. Вона його виманила на зустріч і видала німцям. І, на жаль, він загинув буквально за 3 місяці перед тим, як німці кинули Київ.
Unfortunately, his fate was tragic in that through personal conflict, he and his wife broke up, and she ended up, as a revenge, giving him out to the Germans, and he perished literally a couple of months before Germans were driven out from Kyiv.
Тобто ця антологія складається з таких трагічних доль, і я над нею працював кілька років, поки це зібрав, але я бачу, що матеріал з'являється ще, який мені вдається знайти, і, мабуть, я ще третій том буду.
So this is an anthology of talented people with tragic fates, and I've been working it for many years, but it appears that there is a lot more material to cover. So having published two volumes, I think I probably will work on the third.
Ясно, що для будь-якого видавця видати два товсті томи поезії, які будуть дуже тяжко продаватися, був великим подвигом. І мій найбільший аргумент, який переконав видавця, був таким. Я думаю, що ті 322 невинні душі будуть за тебе молитися. Він погодився видати.
Of course, publishing a hefty anthology of poetry in the contemporary publishing market is a very risky venture, to put it mildly, because they're certainly not going to be selling very well. But I was able to convince my publisher, saying that these 322 souls are going to pray for you for keeping their memory alive, and he decided to go ahead and do it.
Тепер перейдемо до мого роману, і я хотів сказати, що цей роман в Україні викликав жваві дискусії. Багато людей просто не вірили в те, що в цьому романі описано.
Moving on to the novel that I'm speaking about today, it has generated very heated and intense discussion in Ukraine, and many people simply found it unbelievable, the facts, the life that was being described there.
Ще перед тим, як я писав цей роман, і ще не маючи жодних планів для написання, я зустрічався з багатьма старими львів'янами, в тому числі деякими старими євреями, які пережили Янівський концтабір.
Even before I started working on the novel, I cultivated friendships and acquaintanceships with old Lvivites, including all Jewish Lvivites, some of them survivors of the Yaniv concentration camp, who were able to live through all those horrors.
Тому для багатьох читачів було великим відкриттям, що євреї під час війни переховували з каналізації, а львів'яни їх годували, а коли німці відступили, євреї вийшли на поверхню, а діти, які народилися в темряві, в каналізації, плакали, боялися сонця і кричали, що хочуть назад повернутися.
For instance, many people do not know that some Jewish families, through all of the Nazi occupation, were hiding underground in the sewers of the city of Lviv, and were able to survive thanks to locals, non-Jewish locals, who were helping them out with food and provisions. And when they finally were able to come back above ground, there were children who spent several years, small children, underground and did not remember sunlight, and they were crying because sunlight was something different and shocking for them, and they wanted to go back into the darkness.
Викликало деякі заперечення критиків те, що у мене вийшло так, що цей період 39-41 рік, коли була совєтська окупація, показаний значно глибше і жорстокіше, ніж період німецької окупації.
Some critics found it objectionable that in the novel, to some readers, the period of the first Soviet occupation, 39-41, is shown as in some ways more brutal and more horrifying than the Nazi occupation.
На жаль, саме так сталося, що саме завдяки совєтській окупації Львів втратив майже 90% свого населення.
But the truth is that due to that Soviet occupation, Lviv lost almost 90% of its original inhabitants.
Частина поляків, українців була вивезена на Сибір, в Казахстан. Після війни поляки змусили виїхати в Польщу. Євреї під час війни були знищені. українці дуже багато емігрували.
Because what happened? Many Poles, Ukrainians, Jews, representatives of all ethnic groups who were deported to Siberia and Kazakhstan. During the war, obviously, the remainder of the Jewish community, most of it perished in the Holocaust. At the end of the war, many Ukrainians emigrated. And at the very end of the war, most of the local Poles were forcibly resettled into Poland.
Яка, що ці трагедії винні більшовки, це вони, зокрема, я вважаю, повинні поділити відповідальність за Голокост, оскільки вони все робили для того, щоб євреї не покидали Західної України і не давали їм транспорту для евакуації.
And I also believe it is important to say that the Soviets share the blame for the Holocaust in these areas because they were obstructing attempts of the local Jewish community to flee the area and did not allow them to evacuate as they did from other areas which were under Soviet rule for a longer period of time.
Деяких молодих критиків здалося, що опис того, як офіцерські жінки червоних офіцерів, які зайняли будинки львів'ян і знайшли там гардероб, і вдягали нічні сорочки і ходили в них до театру. Вважали, що це якийсь бородатий анекдот, що це неправда.
Some younger people and younger critics objected to me telling the story about how the wives of some Soviet officers who moved into the apartments of the deported families, which still had the clothing intact in the wardrobes, ended up wearing nightgowns, nightshirts to the opera, thinking that those were fancy dresses.
Нічні сорочки були прозорі, а під сходом були вироби совєтських фабрик, які не вражали своїм дизайном.
Especially because those 90s were semi-transparent and underneath you could see the very Soviet style underwear that they were wearing.
Це викликало великий сміх у львів'ян. Але після того, як мені дорікнули, що це, мабуть, якась вигадка, я опублікував уривок зі спогадів. Тобто я зрозумів, що як я буду посилатися на спогади галичан, поляків, це не є жодним аргументом. Я надрукував уривок зі спогадів Юлії Сонцевої, росіянки, дружини Олександра Довженка.
And so I had to prove my point, and I understood that if I were to appeal to memoirs and documentary evidence by the local Western Ukrainian or Polish population, those critics would not buy it. But I found a fragment from the memoirs of Yulia Sontseva, the prominent Soviet silent film actress and later the second wife of the great Ukrainian film director Oleksandr Dovzhenko and a notable film director in her own right.
Вона була сама очевидцем того, як ці офіцерські жінки приймували в нічних сорочках до театру, а за ними йшла ціла череда львів'ян і показували пальцями і сміялися.
And she herself witnessed some of these officers' wives dressed in 90s going to the theaters and the shocked and laughing native Lvivites staring at them.
В романі також описана героїчна оборона Львова перед німцями. Львів тоді обороняла, звичайно, польська армія, і це якось вважалося в Україні, що про це не варто розповідати.
Also another, to this point, little told episode of the history of World War II is given prominence in the novel. And that is the defense of Lviv during the first Nazi invasion of September 1939. Because the Nazi troops made it as far as Lviv, and it was being defended by the locals, together with what remained at that point of the Polish army. But in the Soviet official version of the Great Patriotic War, of course, this was not an episode worth mentioning.
Але в цій польській армії було багато українців, зокрема серед офіцерського складу. І чимало українців потім загинули в Катині, коли їх розстріляли більшовки вже в 41-му році.
And one also should remember that in the Polish army that was defending Lviv, there were many ethnic Ukrainians, both as soldiers as and officers. And so at the victims of the Katyn massacre, where the Soviets perpetrated in 1940, where many Polish officers of Polish army were executed, they were actually ethnic Ukrainians as well.
Ця річна оборона Львова тривала 10 днів. До часу, як ми знаємо, Францію захопили за 5 днів, Бельгію, Голландію теж за 5.
Even though the Nazi blitzkrieg in places like Belgium and France succeeded in overpowering local resistance, often in as little as 5 days, Lviv was able to resist for 10 days in September of 1939.
Львів'яни змушені були скласти зброю тільки тоді, коли підійшли зі сходу червоні війська, і тоді вже вони не мали змоги протистояти двом таким ворогам.
And they gave up only when Soviet troops arrived from the east in the partition of Poland between the Nazi and the Soviet army in September of 1939.
Ну, і щоб скрасити, щоб вас трошки розвеселити, я, може, прочитаю уривок дещо такий веселий. Справа того, що в цьому романі є і сумні сторінки, і веселі, і от це буде.
So, I'm talking about many sad things now, but to prove that things are different, and they're not only sad stories, but also joyful, and humorous and uplifting stories in the novel, I'm now going to read a fragment which is precisely of that kind. It is the on your handout, it starts at the bottom of page 12. One day, an extraordinary event happened.
Перш ніж читати, я поясню, що тут згадується Болда, це мати Йоська, товариша головного героя. А Лія, сестра Йоська, в яку закоханий головний герой.
So, the characters mentioned here are Golda, the mother of one of the four friends who is Jewish, Йосько, Йосип, Joseph is the Jewish friend, and Лія is his sister, and the Ukrainian friend is in love with Лія, the sister.
Головний герой, від імені якого ведеться розповідь, працював в поховальному закладі, який називався Хором.
And our main character, who narrates this episode, the Ukrainian friend, at the time, he is the first person narrative, he was working at a funeral parlor, which is called Charon, as the guy who ferried, the boat across the River Styx.
Одного дня трапилася надзвичайна подія. Примчала до нас захекана Голда і сповістила, що в них у хаті лежить труп. Моя мама і на руками сплеснула, а бабця відразу залила окропом якесь зілля, аби напоїти перелякану Голду, бо та ніяк не могла віддихатися і махала собі хустинкою коло обличчя. З тих уривків фраз, які вона визойкувала і шіптала, ми втямили лише одне – труп належав ведистові, який вже не раз залицявся до Лії. А тепер він вислідив, коли вона була у хаті сама, і спробував її зґвалтувати. А Лія, боронячись, луснула його патерні по голові. Але що луснула не денцем, а кантом, то розсікла йому скроню. Він лежить пляцком, як довгий, з бордянкою, залитою кров'ю, і не дихає. Саме в такому непривабливому вигляді застали його Голда з Йоськом, повернувшись з крамниці. І знову всі погляди скерувалися в мій бік, даючи зрозуміти, що моя роль спасителя ще не завершилася. Ну що ж, зітхнув я. Ідіть туди і чекайте на мене, а я пожену до пана Кнофлика, чи вже і цього разу нас порятує. На похоронному закладі пана Кнофлика тріпотів червоний прапор, а на вивісці красувався свіжий напис «Червоний Харон». «І що ти си гадаєш?» – кивав на вивіску пан Кнофлик. «Тепер то мій оберіг». Уже сюди зазирав не один чубарик та все запитував, «Как не увидеть товариша Харона?» Я відповідав завжди однаково, товариш Харон на совіщанні в Москві. І має святий спокій. А днями приталіпився якийсь совєтський жит і запитав, а не тот ли это Гриша Харон, который був начальником Житомирського НКВД? Я кивнув. Тоді він, передайте йому привіт, якщо будуть проблеми, я в госснабженні. Рішаю всі питання. Але я до вас знову дуже делікатні справи, стишив я голос. А пан Кнофлик мене відразу забрав до свого кабінету і наготовився слухати. Голда Мількер має нову халепу, цього разу через доньку. Коли до них у гості завітав один НКВДист, Лія вирішила пригостити його яєчнею. взяла в руки пательню і тільки не намірилася покласти її на плиту, як НКВД-сту її конче захорілося її обняти. Але послизнувся на крапельці олії і луснувся головою в самий кант пательні. Та так нещасливо, що теперка лежить горі пузом, а дух його витає десь над високим замком. «Оу!» – похитав головою пан Кнофлик. «Так то халеба! Мусимо його порядно поховати. І тобі неймовірно пофортунило, бо якраз має дуже вигідну труну, глибоку і широку. Наготувались ми її для одного ємостя, котрий лежав при смерті, а був дуже тенький, був такий грубий, щоб в ті двері не вліз. Але він передумав умирати і зараз знову брикає. І жере макагіки з марципанами. А труна стоїть? То ми знаєш, що зробимо? Покладемо твого гостя на спід, а зверху пані Топольську. Гадаю, він не буде проти, якщо доведеться йому лежати під кобітою. Та де, то був ще той жевжик, не пропускав жодної спідниці. А, ну то люкс. Ти лише перевези мені його сюди. Зачекайте, а родина пані Топольської ніц не буде мати проти? Яка родина, нема родини. То була самотня кобіта, стара діва, але добре вирозуміла і не забула відкласти гроші на свій похорон. У тестаменті так і написала. Хочу лежати вигідно, просторо і м'яко. Усі три пункти будуть дотримані. Але скажи, твій гість був у військовій формі? А як же, ще й при пістолеті. То мусиш прихопити для нього броня. Отут у пашці є чудовий гарнітур пана Цєпи, коли його в нього вдягали, він тріснув на спині по швах. І родина вирішила придбати йому іншого, хоча я їх переконав, що для пана Цєпи то не грає роль. Бо так його спини на цім світі вже ніхто не побачить. А вони знають, що мені на те відповіли? А на тім світі? Я стулив писк. Так же бери. І тиснув мені в руки пакунок, але ще не відпустив, бо спало йому на думку, що варто було б того нашого гостя загримувати. Ану ж дорогою стріну якогось його кумпля, і пан Кнофлик вручив мені ще й руду бороду, сиву перуку і коробку з фарбами для писка. Що вам сказати, покійник виглядав тепер ліпше, як з життя. Колишнього вилицювата мордяка, налита кров'ю, злагіднівши, дуже добре надавалася до образу втихомиреного і задоволеного колишнім життям дядя. Тобто дідуся. Чорний гарнітур пасував, як влитий. З кишеньки на грудях стирчала біла троянда. Чорні окуляри довершили картину, і коли дядя опинився в ташці, яку ми з Йоськом пхали, насвистуючи поперед себе, усі перехожі вічливо кивали головами, усміхалися, а дехто навіть знімав капелюха, бо дядя скидався на живого. І гріх було не привітатися з таким приємним фацетом. Навіть пан Кнофлик замилувався і засмокав вдоволено. Допоміг нам вийняти трупа з тачки і покласти до труни. Поруч на столі чекала на свою чергу пані Топольська. Була в тілі і вбрана в темно-синю сукню з білими коронками. Видно було, що приготувала її саме для такої урочистої хвилини. У воскових пальцях тримала образок, а сухі міцно зціплені вуста скидалися на ніколи в житті не ціловані. Іно я про це подумав, як раптом у нас усіх волосся стало дуба, а пан Кнофлик ухопився за серце, бо наш дядько раптом ожив і сів у труні. Руками тримався за стінки і здивовано роззирався на всі боки, не в стані второпати, куди потрапив. Потім обмацав своє обличчя, скинув окуляри і ще раз розвернувшись, пролепетів. «А де я?» Перезирнувшись із Йоськом, я вже почав розглядатися за якоюсь доброю ломакою, щоб відправити дядя назад у тому самому напрямку, в якому рухалася його річна душа. Але якогось дідька завернуло назад, аби завдати нам ще більше прикростей. Та пан Кнофлик спинив мене. «Зачекай», а відтак звернувся до дядя. «Ми знайшли вас непритомного на вулиці. Ви пам'ятаєте, хто ви і де живете?» НКВД струснув головою і став досліджувати свої кишені. Отак там нічого не було. «А документи в мене були?» «Ні», – відповіли ми в один голос. «Не було нічого. Мабуть, ви з лікарні вийшли».
«З якої лікарні?»
«Ну, та є у нас лікарня, які, власне, і тримають таких, як ви, що втратили пам'ять».
«Да, я нічого не пам'ятаю, що умер».
Тут пан Кнофлик втішено потер руки і набрав номер кульбарківської лічниці. Це нас така любове поживіння. Та повідомив, щоб забрали варіата, який, напевно, від них відшкурнув. «Зараз вони приїдуть», – шепнув нам.
«Можна я що поліжу?»
– спитав небіжчик. І знову ліг собі у домовині, склавши руки на грудях. Так його і застали санітари, що приїхали з божевільні. Пан Кнофлик розповів, що ми підібрали цього чоловіка непритомного, думаючи, що він мертвий. А він ожив і тепер без пам'яті. Лікарі нахилились над труною і закивали головами. Знаємо його, то дурний Гілько. Утік від нас ще років 5 тому. Ану, вставай, загукали йому. НКВД знову підвівся і оторопіло провів очима по присутніх.
Как мене зовут?
Та не придурюйся, Гільку, бо зараз ті дам такого заштрика, що згадаєш, як твоя бабця дівкою була. Сказав до них санітарів, а по тих словах вони підняли його з домовини, підхопили під руки і, хутенько вбравши гайману сорочку, повлекли до авто без вікон. НКВД ще щось гурлав невиразне, але ніхто вже на нього не звертав уваги. Ага, підсумував пан Кнофлик. Втратила наша пані топольська кавалєра. Що за життя під хлопом не була, то й по смерті на хлопові не полежала.